we need to do is ultimately get the pipeline built. And, you know, we're actually, have been in courts on about, oh, I think we've had about 14 or 15 different legal skirmishes that often had BC on the other side of them since this pipeline started. And so far, we're winning pretty much every one, knock on wood. You know, we never want to plan what the courts are going to say, but we've been confident thus far. So, you know, sometimes we have to agree to disagree. But in this case, I think that you can meet the objectives that of coastline safety and environmental responsibility that I know some people in BC are worried about, while also ensuring that we support working people. And that when you have people advocate for only one side of that equation and you throw the other to the curb, you risk achieving either of them. And you essentially get to a place where you cannot achieve either. That's a model that's been followed by both sides of the argument for far too long. And what we're trying to do is do something different that will actually get us to success.
One more question for you.
You've spoken about taking an equity stake in the project. You've spoken about giving financial support. Can you give some more information, some more color, something up to date? Will you take over the entire pipeline? What's the plan?
Well, you know, as I was saying yesterday, the reality is that it's a very complex set of negotiations that are going on right now. What Alberta said is that we would do what it took to get this done. There are a number of different leverage points within that process. They are all at play right now, and there's a good deal of important negotiations going on. As things stand right now, it is not in the best interests of Albertans or their taxpayers or in the public interest of getting this pipeline built for me to be getting into the details in public at this point. But suffice to say, Alberta is fully engaged in this, and we're not going to let this fail.
Let's go to the phone lines now. Operator, please give me the first caller.
Our first question comes from Chris Barco of the Calgary Herald. Your line is open.
Hi, Premier. Sorry if I'm repeating the question. That it comes out a bit late. But I'm just wondering, what is the message that the business community in BC travel to Alberta should take on the fact that you just passed Bill 12 and are threatening to turn down the tax for their province?
Well, you know, I think that the, you know, it's interesting. I think they understand the importance of this issue. And obviously, we've said before, we are not in the business of trying to create hardship for people outside of Alberta, whether they be members of the British Columbia, the BC business community, or working people, average families in British Columbia. What has to happen, though, is that we have to make progress on this pipeline. And as Albertans, we have to be able to maximize the return we receive for our resources as well as we can, and ultimately our ability to do that is good for the national economy. So I think that most of the business owners there, they are very much aligned with us on achieving those objectives. And you know, I'm sure they're not super pumped about Bill 12, but at the same time, I also think they see where we are headed with this. And at the end of the day, we share a common destination that we all want to get to.
Do you have a follow-up, Chris?
Yeah, you mentioned today that the wine ban has been suspended but was not revoked. What would it take for you, I guess, to reinstitute that? Are you looking at other retaliatory measures that you could possibly?
You know, not at this point. Again, as I say, that is part of the overall process that's underway right now, where we are trying to negotiate an outcome that is focused on dealing primarily with the May 31st date. You know, when you are engaged in a complicated process of trying to persuade people to get to the point that you need them to be, sometimes from a strategic point of view, it's important for a lot of it to be very much out front where you're talking to people like we are today. Sometimes you need to be a bit more strategic in your timing, and the question you ask about is one of those latter times.
We'll take one final question from the phone. Operator, please include the next caller.
The next question comes from Jeff Morgan of the Financial Times.
I'm sorry if you've already answered this. The connection was poor or something. Are you communicating any sort of strategies for these companies that are here to visit to prepare for a potential turning off of the tasks, as you said yesterday?
We're not speaking specifically about those issues with these companies today. We've spent our time talking more generally about the fact that we share an ultimate goal, at the end of this path, and that is to get this pipeline built, and that is to send a message across Canada to economic players both inside and outside of the energy industry that Canada is a place that respects the rule of law, and Canada is a place where when you make a decision you can get things done. And so that has been where we have a very common cause, and where we talked about the need to get to that shared destination.
Do you have a follow-up, Jeffrey?
Yeah, and the Vancouver Board of Trade communicated any fear over the potential of carrying off the staff, do you?
And so far we have not had any conversations on.
And we'll leave it there. Thanks everyone.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Carolyn. Appreciate it.